So hopefully you're here for a talk on construction management and economics. If you're not, now's the time to leave. Okay. It says there, my name's Dr. Mark Shelbourne, and I'm fresh here from the university, but I've had experience in the UK for probably the past 6-7 years teaching over there, programme directorship and those kind of things. So although the environment's different over here, in terms of university life, it's pretty much the same as it is in the UK. So what I'm going to talk about is give you a little bit of an overview of what I feel the construction industry is all about, okay, and then some information that you're probably here for about the course, entry requirements and those kind of things that we do here, and also give you some information about some of the opportunities that are open to you, overseas travel, international studentships, those kind of things, and then we'll try and give a bit of a summary at the end, and if you've got any questions, I'll try and answer them for you. So the construction industry itself, it's been around for a long time. It's creative as well as practical. Here we have some examples of some buildings around the world. You're probably all aware of the Sydney Opera House there. Anybody know where this place is on the bottom left? Pardon? Bottom left, yes. Okay, I'll put it out. That's the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. But you're quite right. On the right-hand side here is the Pantheon in Rome. And I'll put the Pantheon picture up because this roof here is actually made of concrete. Okay? So concrete as a material, it's only second in the world to the water that's the most used material, but it's been around for a long time. Okay. So as well as being creative and practical, these cutouts in the roof of the Pantheon are there not because they're it's aesthetically pleasing, if you like. It's there to reduce the weight of the concrete so the roof can actually stand up. So if you actually go here, and most people just look at all the frescoes and all the sculptures in the bottom half, look up at the ceiling, it's amazing. Okay, so the construction is creative as well as practical. Okay, and it surrounds us. You know, somewhere sat down, designed this room, designed the whole buildings. Okay, you could be part of that. Whether you're costing it, whether you're designing it, whether you're managing it, there's always somebody out there that needs something doing. Okay, this is quite an old picture, obviously, of Adelaide, but it surrounds us all the time. It's controversial. If you go across the road, look across the road from here, we have the new Adelaide Hospital. Obviously, it's been in the news quite a lot. Some people say that the local council could be spending at least $1 million a day just on interest payments for the cost of the project. So, you know, you may not make the decision of whether that project goes ahead or not, but you might be asked to produce reports on costings, on planning, running the project that feeds into those decisions. Okay? Obviously, it's the Adelaide Oval's quite a controversial thing at the moment because nobody can decide where to put a bridge. Everywhere you look on the news or in the newspapers, everybody's arguing about the position of a bridge, where the new development's going to go for Adelaide Oval. So as well as practical, creative, you can be asked to do quite controversial things. And therefore, it's never boring. Okay? You come into work every day. I come into work every day here, and it's never boring for me at the moment. But, you know, you go into industry, you never know what it's going to turn up when you get in there. You know, the phone rings, something's happened on site, you need to sort out this problem, that problem. So we like to think that the construction is never boring. You may have an office job, you may be out on site all the time, but the practical skills we give you here mean that you can do either job. And as I say, the construction is never boring. It will never stop happening. Okay, you're coming into an industry that somebody always wants something doing to, whether it's an extension to your neighbour's house or whether it's a new project the size of the Adelaide Hospital. You know, somebody somewhere always wants something built or renovated. Okay, anybody know where this one is? Thank you. No? This is actually called the Fred and Ginger Building. It's in Prague. But what's interesting about this is the facade here and the curved structure. You know, so although it looks good, somebody somewhere has actually designed it to make it look nice, but it has a function as well. Okay? So construction is never stop happening. So whether you study here or you study somewhere else, construction is a great industry to get into because there's always something for you to do. Okay? But it relies on people. Inspirational can-do people, if you like. You don't have to be the brightest person in the world to get on in the construction industry. Okay. In fact, most employers I talk to don't really want the high flyers and distinctions, high distinctions in this world. They want the practical, can-do people. Okay? So, we can give you the skills to do that, but don't think you have to get the highest degree possible, although it's nice, to be able to work in the industry. The industry is all about people. If you can look after people, manage people, get on with people, it stands you in good stead. And we try to give you those communication skills and all those kind of things in our courses here at UniSA. So we throw down the gauntlet to you, try and make you join with us in the future. So where do you fit in? Okay, there's loads of different jobs in the construction industry, and this very busy slide here tries to simplify what the industry is all about. Okay, so we'll take an example. Your next door neighbour wants to build, or you want to build a new house here. Okay, I'll stand this side. Okay, so you want a new house, the client wants a new house, and what they do, they ask an architect to design something for them. Okay, we have a separate school for architecture if you want to go into that kind of area. They come up with some plans, and then a quantity surveyor, or building economist, construction economist, will actually cost how much that house is going to be. So they will count how many bricks there are, they'll count how much concrete you need, how many roof tiles, how much tin-sheeted roof you need. And they will produce what's called a bill of quantities, okay, and then that goes out to what we call tender. And construction organisations then say, well, I can do this for this amount, and I can do it for that amount. In the middle here, we have a kind of typical structure of a construction company, if you like. Contractors, directors, and all the rest of it. So all those documentation that you may be asked, you could be part of a team producing those documents, get sent out to a number of different people, and they talk about how much the building's going to cost. If you're successful and you win, happy days, you give it to a project manager or a construction manager, and all these different people around this side are then involved in the project. And you could be any one of these people. Okay? Generic degree in construction management. You could be any one of these people here. You know, you could even specialise in construction lawyer. There's always something out there for you to do. Okay? And this is probably where the trainee graduates come out and start working in the industry. But what happens in the industry is, as we're going down the timeline down here, the client generally changes their mind. Okay? And what they really want is a house this big at the top here. But the challenge for the industry is to produce a house that big for the cost of something that big to manage the client expectation. And you as a construction manager, a building economist, quantity surveyor, whatever you want to call them, could be that person that needs to manage that process. Which is why we say it's never boring, need inspirational people and those kind of things. Okay? And then once that happens, you know, we have some kind of like maintenance function going on as well. So let's look at the industry as a whole, if you like, here in Australia. If I'm rambling too much, you're not understanding what I'm saying, please shout out and I'll try and explain stuff to you. Okay? This is a very generalistic view of what happens in construction in Australia. Okay? 50% of it is all about residential buildings. Okay, and that's reflected in the courses we do here. Non-residential, we mean things like office plots, hospitals right across the way, more commercial buildings. And there's an engineering function. Okay, although you can do an engineering degree, you know, learn how to build roads, build bridges, and all the complexities that they have, with a construction management and economics degree, you can manage an engineering project. It's all about project management. We give you the generic skills that enable you to do those kind of opportunities. So don't think, because I'm doing construction management and economics, I can't go into the engineering back field. In fact, we encourage you to go into the engineering field just as much, because we give you those general managerial skills and opportunities. Okay. So most of the work you'll come across is in a residential area. You know, the kind of small extensions, perhaps building a house. If you're lucky, you get on probably a million and a half residential new build and those kind of things. So that's the way the industry kind of operates. So let's look a little bit more. So I've talked about the industry as a whole, and hopefully you've all been excited about what you're going to go into. The career options for coming to do the construction management and economic degree here at the university. You can be a construction manager. Construction manager means you're out on site, you're managing the process, you're managing the day-to-day activities. almost like firefighting if it's not going so well. You could be a construction economist, I tend to call them quantity surveyors. But you can work for the clients as a quantity surveyor, but you can also work as a contractor as a quantity surveyor. And those two people are the people that are managing, if you like, the accountancy of the construction project. So if you're good at maths, you like numbers, QS is your forte perhaps. But the thing with QS is you perhaps don't spend as much time out on site. So if you're an outdoorsy type person, you perhaps be a construction manager or a building control surveyor. Building control surveyors generally come round and check the work, checks being done to standards and all those kind of things. They're called something, it's generally termed building surveying here, but in the UK building surveying has a different connotation. So I call them building control surveyors. And at the end of the day, your goal is to become a project manager or a director. And this is where the big money is. You become a project manager, director, probably by the time, age 45 maybe. You know, you're getting a lot of money to manage projects the size of the Adelaide Hospital, for example. And that's when your real money kicks in. So the overall goal, I feel, is if for somebody to become a project manager director, and that's when you really fulfill. You know, you are managing a big group of people to run projects for you. How am I doing time? Okay. So, as a construction professional, we like to think you will have a number of different qualities, and our course will hopefully bring these things out of you. So you will supervise people and process. As I said before, construction industry is all about managing people, getting on with people. We'll give you technical and practical knowledge, and with the generic skills you have, hopefully you can apply those to different construction projects. You will analyse problems. You will go to a site, you know, perhaps they haven't done the soil investigation as well as they could have done, and you have a problem with, you found a well that hasn't been discovered. So you would then have to think about how you would go about filling the well in and all those kind of things. As with most things in life, it's the same here at the university, you have admin duties. It's all about paperwork. Although the paperwork is becoming more streamlined with the advent of more computerized technologies that enable you to run projects, but you still have to fill out paperwork. But at the end of the day, the construction industry is always about acting in the community interests. Going back to what I was saying about controversial, there'll always be somebody that doesn't like your house extension. There'll always be somebody that doesn't like the design of, I don't know, maybe the campus here with the blue and yellow on it. Okay? So you're always acting in the community interest to try and make the built environment in your vicinity or your locality the best it can be. And you would understand, respect ideas and skills of applied disciplines. So as I said before, you may not be a civil engineer, but you'll be able to understand what their processes are in terms of managing their particular projects. Okay. So you'll understand, are there any architects here? No architects here. You'll understand that architects just sketch a little thing on the back on a piece of paper, then hand it over and expect everybody else to produce it. Okay? I've been very nasty to architects there, but that's the general view of what construction managers feel about architects. Okay, so you know, you will have to understand how all the disciplines work within the construction field. Our course here has an international reputation, it's recognised by a number of industry bodies throughout the world. Okay, the bottom three are here in Australia. So we have the Australian Institute of Quantity Surveyors, Building Surveyors, and the Institute of Building. But the rest are all international organisations. Okay, so we have the Board of Quantity Surveyors in Malaysia, Singapore Institute of Surveyors and Valuers, I won't read them all out. The RICS is a UK one. CIOB is UK as well. And as a graduate of the university here, you are exempt from certain conditions that enable you to become professionally accredited with all of these institutions. Okay. So if you're going to go, I'm a member of the CIOB in the UK. Well, I was in the UK, but now it's a global organisation, obviously. And it says passport to the world there, and I was talking to one of my colleagues on Friday, and he said it's a visa to the world, because he likes to think that perhaps you may come back and work in the Australian construction industry. But it's also an opportunity for you to go and work abroad as well. Okay, the qualifications and the degree you get is recognised worldwide. So what do we do basically now? This is coming down onto the courses, if you like, and perhaps why you're here. We have, as our flagship course, we have a full year, a 4 years full-time. Are there any part-time students here thinking of doing part-time? Okay, I won't talk about part-time so much then, but part-time you can do it over 8 years, which is the Bachelor of Construction Management and Economics degree. And that's our kind of like flagship four-year degree. We also have a degree called the Bachelor of Built Environment, which is over 3 years, and an associate degree in the built environment over 2 years. Okay, so these are the main courses we do within our part of the school. Entry requirements, obviously you have to complete year 12 with the appropriate SACE or equivalent score. And our predicted ATAR numbers for 2012, to get onto the highest degree, the Bachelor of Construction Management and Economics, a four-year degree, you need a score of around 82. The three-year degree, 67 to 70, associate degree, 62 to 65. And I've been asked to point out that ATAR isn't an indicator of how hard the course is. It's an indicator of how much the course is in demand. Okay? If you feel you've only got 64, you can apply to this course. And the way the courses work is, you can, if you successfully complete this course, you can move on to the next one above. Okay, so don't feel that you haven't got 82 points, you can't come into the university. That's not what we're saying. Okay. I'll just put this up and I'll come back to those scores in a minute. You can get bonus points to increase your score. Okay, and by doing this, you can do specific subjects at year 12. Okay, as I said, I'm quite new to this, but I don't fully understand how these bonus points work. But I think if you do these kind of subjects at year 12, you can get bonus points for coming into the university. If you're unsure, I mean, even I'm unsure about this, if you're unsure, please visit the desk over in the Y building, I think we're in, or H building. Okay, we have a dedicated team there, and they'll help you all about that. Okay, but you can get extra points for doing specific subjects. I encourage you to perhaps apply for all three of the courses. Okay? Apply for the top course of 82 ATAR points, and then the one in between and the one below. Okay? No matter which one you get, you get on. Okay? The first year of the courses, all three courses is common. Okay? So it doesn't matter whether you're on the CME, Bachelor of CME, or the Associate degree, you can do the same subjects. Okay? So if maybe you haven't done so well at year 12, you know, you've parted perhaps a little bit too much, you can at least get on one of the courses, and then as you progress through university life, first year, second year, you show your true potential, and then you can just move on to the next one. Okay. If you want to change up, we can do that through SATAC. If you come into the university on a course and you find it a bit of a struggle, you want to perhaps step down a level, we can do that internally. Okay, so it's quite flexible and we can help you out doing those kind of things. Okay. And our students generally come from the top 20% of those who apply. Okay. So this is how it works. Quite a complicated slide here. Okay. So, as I said before, all three degrees do a common first year as well as second year. And if, for example, you do the associate degree, you can step off at that particular point with an associate degree, graduate, and you can perhaps go out and work, you know, into the industry, you know, perhaps as a trainee site manager, those kind of things. If, for example, you want to carry on, we can let you carry on into the third year and again into the fourth year. And as I said, this is our flagship course here. Most students do this level of study. And at the end of it, you can become a specialist construction manager. Okay, you can be a specialist building surveyor, or building control surveyor, or a quantity surveyor. But what a lot of students don't think is you can actually carry on studying. This is the option I took. Okay, I did a undergraduate building surveying degree in the UK, and I had a year out, and then I started doing masters, and then I did a PhD, and then I came into the academic field. Okay, so there are opportunities in terms of teaching. Don't think you have to go out there and build buildings or build roads and all those kind of things. The opportunities you can actually start teaching as well. So as I said before, perhaps if you haven't done so well, you've enrolled in the middle degree, you know, there are opportunities for you to carry on and move up and down the levels. Okay. I've talked about the programme length. These are the kind of things that happen. So in year one, as I say, it's common. And it's all about bringing everybody to the same level in terms of understanding of what construction is all about. Year two, we consolidate those studies. Year three, we extend them. And then if you do the double major year and thesis year in year four, that's where you start choosing your specialities. Okay. And what we're trying to do is base our program on something called experiential learning. So learning on the job. So we'll expect you to do at least 100 days work outside of your studies as part of the degree program. You know, and we'll help you with finding those jobs and those kind of things. So during the summer holidays, you'll perhaps go and work on a construction site for 3 or 4 weeks. I was talking to a colleague, a friend actually, who I've met over here. He's working on building a new railway, and we're talking about trying to get some of our students going to work on his project. We have an international team of... I need to refer to my notes here. An international team of teachers, lecturers, whatever you want to call them here. This is me in Dubai at the top there. You can just see the Burj Khalifa in the background. Amazing place. These guys here, this is George. He's our head of school. This is Simon. He's our head of college, if you like. And this is another lecturer whose name I forget. Sorry. But we are an international team. George, for example, George Delante, he's Italian. Tony Marr comes from Hong Kong. Stephen Pullen comes from the UK. Originally, he's been here about 20 years. Stefan Horland, he's the program director. Okay, he's your first point of contact for questions, queries outside of these kind of events. He's from Sweden. Virginia's a local. Timothy's an Irish fella. Jeremy Coggins is from the UK as well. Sam Barudi, he's actually a Lebanese Australian. Okay. Jean comes from China. Nick Chilesi has come via the UK via Zambia. Tony Wood's a local, I'm from the UK. Kerry's a local. But I read those countries out to give you a flavour of our expertise, if you like. But what we do is we have the bit points at the bottom here, we have 35, at least 35 sessional industrial people that come and talk to our students as well. So these are people working in the industry day in, day out, and they bring their expertise, knowledge, understanding into the classes as well. So we do have quite a lot of expertise coming in from the industry as well. We have sponsorships. I won't read all these out, but there are opportunities. Thank you. There are opportunities for you to get sponsored. I'm running out of time now, so I'm going to go quickly. You can go and study abroad. For example, at Clemson University in the UK, we have a $6,000 scholarship, and you can go and study for study periods over there. Again, in South Bank, Austria, US. And the university will actually pay your airfares for you. So if you feel you want to go and work abroad, there are opportunities there for you to do that. We have something here called BOSS, which is like a student organisation. It gets you in contact with industry professionals. They organise social functions, sporting events and all those kind of things. So that's something you can get involved in. It helps you get employment. We have a 100% employment graduate rate, according to the GCA. Your starting salary may be about 55K, but it significantly increases when you start getting professional accreditation to those organisations I was talking to you about before. That was my phone. Okay. Further information, as I said, speak to Stefan or George, or if you want to come and talk to me, I'm quite happy to talk to you if I can. Websites, phone numbers on the right here. All that information will be on the mobile site. Upcoming again, I'll point you to this. Obviously, we're in a campus called City West. Most of your teaching will be in a campus called City East, which is just down North Terrace on the University of Adelaide site. So, and there's an open day event where you can come along, perhaps spend a bit more time with the lecturers and actually talk a bit more in detail about what you want to do. That's on September the 11th, Sunday afternoon, between 1 and 4. So I point you to that. I'm nearly finished. So we ask you to rise to your potential. You can be doing any number of these things here. Okay. This is a basement wall in the UK that looks like a nuclear bunker. It's about that wide, just for a basement wall. For this house here, this house is probably about $1.5 million house here. We I have a colleague who was actually project managing that, and we used to go around and take videos. You could do something simple like checking drainage. Are these the right rise and fall? Okay, if you don't get your drainage right and it starts sticking, it can be quite unpleasant. This picture here is a picture of the monorail station in Dubai. You could be the steel manager of that. Okay, 2 years out of university, you may get the role of managing all the steel on that particular project. And again, this is a picture in Dubai. You could be managing the importance of tower cranes. You see tower cranes all around construction sites, the most expensive thing you can actually have. And if they're sat idle, doing nothing, you know, you're losing money. So if you actually have to have a tower crane on site, somebody has to manage that process and ensure that it's getting the full potential and usage out of it. That could be one of your roles. Okay. I don't know if you can see this very well. There's some people here cleaning this side of the building. You see that? In yellow jackets? Okay. I was quite surprised when I saw this. You could either be one of those people that are actually cleaning, or you could be the guy at the bottom, or lady at the bottom, telling them that they have to clean. I know which one I'd rather be. Okay? It's a long way up there. Anybody know where this is? It's close. This is the World Trade Center in Bahrain. Okay? And these wind turbines are supposed to produce about a third of the energy for the building. But, you know, it's your future at the end of the day. Okay? You'll get out of life, well, I'm preaching about this, you get out of life what you put into it, and would you rather be the guy, lady, at the bottom here telling them what to do, or one of these people actually abseiling down and cleaning? I know which one I'd rather be, but there might be some adrenaline junkies out there of you that perhaps quite like to do that. Okay? So it's your future at the end of the day, and hopefully you'll come here to the university and fulfill your potential. Okay, that's what I have to say. I believe I'm almost on time. We have around 10 minutes for questions. I'll try and answer some if you want. If you've got any more specific questions, there is a designated booth out in one of the sites that will help you.